service after Christmas. Merry Christmas to everybody, and a Happy New Year in the week to come. I would ask us all to take a moment to quiet ourselves, to still ourselves as we prepare for worship this morning.
Oh, assurance of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, and the bridegroom decks himself with a garland, as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as the garden causes what is sown in to be sprung up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and grace spring up before all the nations. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest, until her benediction shines out like the dawn, and her salvation like the burning torch. The nations shall see your benediction, and all the kings your glory. And ye shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hands of the Lord, and for a royal dominion in the hand of your God.
Also, thank you to the Mabel for leading us in singing, for Stephen for being here on the organ, for Rayanne behind the camera, and for you all here to be here worshiping together in community. And for Bucky, taking part in my jokes. Thank you. Our reading from the Psalms today, Psalm 148. Whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Israel. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom and the favor of God was upon him. Here ends our reading. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy light, in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. We have a little story, the only story we have in our Gospels about Jesus as a child. There are other Gospels and other stories that are abundant. My favorite being Jesus as a young boy who was with his buddies and one of his friends got some clay, some mud, and made this little bird out of clay. And Jesus looked at it and he did the same thing, and all of a sudden he breathed on it and the bird flew away. Nice little story. Shows the importance of Jesus, shows the importance here of Jesus too, also of Jesus' family and how devout they were and did everything under the laws of Israel. They did everything they were supposed to do. They brought him up to Jerusalem. It wasn't an easy trek, but they brought him to Jerusalem. He was devoted, brought into the temple, and then presented him. Did what they were supposed to. And yet we saw two other people in the story, Simeon and Anna, who they see Jesus and know instantly who this fellow is. Simeon goes over to him, holds him in his arms, praises God, tells Mary and Joseph the story of what he experienced and what he's feeling here about this boy who he had never met before, and they were amazed at what he was saying. Imagine Mary put this all with her. Remember we had the story of the shepherds came and told them, and she pondered those in her heart. The stories of the wise men coming, and she had those stories as well. And she's putting all these stories together about who her son is and what this means. Who he is meant to be. We have Anna as well, praising God and then telling everybody about what she saw and the stories of Jesus begin. Stories of who this young God is. He goes home, grows in wisdom, and we find him 30, at the age of 30, when his ministry starts. All good stories of who this guy is and what he's meant to be, who he's meant to be, how he has affected people from pretty much day one. Day one. You know, I met Dolores when I was 18, and she was 16. This is a advice for men. Get your women early before they smarten up. But when I look back on our relationship, I cannot remember a time when she wasn't a part of my life. Even when I think of moments before I was 18, she always seems to be there. I'm sure you experienced that too with your significant other. There's something about people, that relationships that we have, that are so meaningful to us that they affect us from day one, no matter when we meet them. And these are the experiences people are saying that Jesus was something, was so something in their relationship that they cannot figure a time when he wasn't. When he wasn't. How intimate is that relationship that they can't figure a time in their lives when he wasn't a part of it? When he wasn't a part of it. We have this story immediately following our Christmas story. Before we have, next week, we have the baptism of our Lord Sunday. But Jesus comes in, he was born, and he's dedicated. And the symbolism around this is that we are dedicating our lives to him. We've experienced that birth. We felt those feelings. We've bubbled up with emotion. And now we respond. We say, Jesus was important to us. Jesus is important to us. Now I move on as if he was always part of who I am. Something about the relationship changes and deepens. And we look to the scriptures, we look to his story, we look to his teachings, and he tells us what he expects of us, how he expects us to act, who he expects us to be, where God is calling us. And we try to live that way. It becomes very personal for us that we try to live that way. And in the decisions that we make and in the roads we travel, we try to do the best we can with where God is calling us to be. For some of us, that takes on a real personal level, and it becomes a pious thing. It becomes a, I am so affected that it changes who I am and how I treat people, how I am with people, and it becomes very personal and very close. Very personal and very close. For others, it becomes broader. God is calling me into community, and as a part of that community, it's my responsibility to help everybody within that community. Within that community. You know, we've got these stupid face masks that everybody complains about. Everybody, I don't complain about. I haven't had a cold yet this year. I have a kid in school. I've usually had 7 colds by now. It's keeping me healthy. It's keeping everybody healthy. And I hear these people all the time saying that this is interfering with my freedom. This is interfering with my freedom. What a load of horse manure. This is a symbol of my responsibility within community. Because it's not keeping me safe. It's keeping everyone I'm in contact with safe. And it has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with everybody else. The responsibility within community. Because that is where God is calling me to be. God is calling us to be. You know, what's interesting is that reading Kenny gave from Isaiah. People, when they were writing, the gospel writers, when they were writing, were trying to put into context where Jesus fit, not just in relationship to where they were geographically, but also theologically and politically. And theologically, we have Isaiah talking about God coming and bringing righteousness back, God coming and bringing praise back, God coming and making things better when things around us are so strange and chaotic. And the writers of the gospel looked at that, Luke looked at that, and he said, you know what? God is represented as righteousness. God is represented as praiseworthy, bringing praise back, people looking to God first before anybody else. And they make note of that. We have our story here that Jesus walks into the temple with his family and he meets, first of all, Simeon, who was very righteous and devout. Very righteous and devout. Tying that story back into, this is God in the temple, holding Jesus and praising Jesus and speaking of Jesus. And then we have an interesting story about Anna, who comes. She's there all alone. She's older, not as old as Bucky, but older. She's been alone most of her life. She would have got married at a young age, only was married for 7 years before she was widowed. Spent most of her life sorrowful for that loss. Most of her life alone. And she devotes herself to God. Devotion again. Comes to the temple there day and night, praising God. What's interesting about Anna, we don't hear about her encounter with Jesus. We hear about after Jesus left. Everybody, what does it say? Everybody, she speaks about the child to all who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. All who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. You know, I think about that line. I think about that line, and I think about what the politics were in Jesus' day. As we know, Rome had come in, and they had taken Israel, and we've got it into the geopolitical stuff of all of that. Rome was there. Rome put people in place to keep Rome's interests at the foreground, to the detriment of Jerusalem's interests, to the detriment of Israel's interests. And people were seething with what was happening to them. They believed God had given them this land and Rome was taking it away from them. They believed that this land was a gift of God. And we see that fervor still today, that this land was a gift of God and these people are taking it. And they're doing things in our community and they're making us do things in our community that goes against the dictates of what we believe God is, where we believe God is calling us to be. And people were seething. And we have Anna going around to these people, telling them about Jesus. Telling them about what she experienced. You know, years ago we had a big debate, centuries ago, about the place of church and state in society. And yet, look, you still see it all over the place. Jesus was born into politics, whether we want to believe it or not. Jesus was born into a political situation that he responded to. And most of the things that he talked about, though we take it out as spiritually, were political. And what he's saying is that the kingdom of God is not something for us to sit in a room and pray and feel good about ourselves. Well, sometimes we need to do that for focusing and for balance. But the kingdom of God is to ensure that it's for everybody. It's for everybody. And we all have a responsibility to see that everybody in our society thrives. The coronavirus taught us that everybody in the world, every single person in the world needs to be vaccinated, not just us, for this thing to go away, for this thing to stop being a threat. It's not just the people in this church we need to worry about. It's not just the people in this community or this island or this province or this country, but everybody in the world we have a responsibility for. Christmas. The birth of a child. The stories of a boy. Miracles of man, the teachings of a God. And we come here today to dedicate ourselves to that. Amen. Our next hymn is It Came Upon the Midnight Clear.
Thank you.
Help us not to stay focused on the infant Jesus in the manger or the temple or the child that the Magi visited. Help us instead to hear the message of the living Christ who calls us to discipleship. By your Spirit, guide us to take the message of unconditional love that is Christmas and to share it with all the world, especially those who are in need, who are hurting, who are disillusioned, who have given up. We pray in the name of Jesus, child in the manger, promise in the temple, light for the nations. And now let us join in the prayer where our Lord Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. For the offerings that have come in this past week, let us pray. As Mary and Joseph dedicated their child Jesus in the temple, so we dedicate ourselves to you, O God. Use us in your service. Give us a prophetic voice like Anna and Simeon. Give us the courage of the Magi, and like all of creation, may we glorify you with all our
city.
in all that you do. Go to celebrate the presence of God in all of creation. Clothe yourself in love, and let the peace of Christ move in your hearts. Your own wisdom and grace, and know that